Hi, welcome to another edition of Tech Topics. My name is Al Harper, and I'm an SRE here in RTP Durham. And today we're going to be talking about remote sites and how you can use them to back up your information to a remote cluster and even fail over in the event of disaster recovery. The main points that we'll be hitting today will be how to configure a remote site, how to replicate a snapshot to the remote site, how to migrate the information to the remote site in the event of a planned failover, and how to activate the remote site in the event of disaster recovery. In our demo today, we'll be using NOS version 4.1.1.4. So let's jump right into the demo. All right, as we get ready to configure our remote site, we have our two different Prism pages pulled up for our source and remote site, and we're on the data protection page under table. So let's click on plus remote site and do physical cluster. All right, so we have a bunch of different options here. If you enable the proxy, then all the destined remote traffic will go through one CVM. This can help when configuring your firewall. We also have the option to use the SSH tunnel. This is mainly for Cloud Connect to back up to AWS. This will hurt performance, and we don't recommend using it on any production systems. Under capabilities, we have backup and disaster recovery. Backup will allow us to replicate our snapshots to the remote site, but not actually activate them or migrate them to bring those online. So it's just for storage. Disaster recovery is going to allow migration and activation. Please note that disaster recovery is not available on our starter license. And then we have addresses. Under addresses, we're going to put the IP address that we want to connect to on the remote side. So let's start by filling out the name. We'll call it Tech Topics. And notice we get this nice alert underneath it that says, ensure Tech Topics is also configured cluster 3541 as a remote site. This is very important. And what we want to do here is make sure that everything we configure on the source site, we also mirror on the remote site. If you don't do this, then the replications will not work. So we're going to leave this checked as is, and addresses for the IP address, we want to use the cluster external IP address whenever possible. If you don't have that set up, then you can use the CVM IP addresses, but it's important here to add in every CVM IP address that can be used. This is in case one is not available due to a node being out, you can still go through and replicate your data. So in our case, we're going to use 10.63.4.202. And that's going to be the cluster external IP address of our remote site. We don't need to add a port since the port by default is 22. But do note that when you're opening up your firewalls, you must have ports 2009, 2020, 9440, and 22 all open. So let's click Add. And then we need to go into the advanced settings as well. When we go in here, we have a few different options as well. Under maximum bandwidth, you can limit the amount of bandwidth that's going to be used as we transfer data between the remote sites. Please keep in mind that the CVMs are intelligent enough to put this on the back burner, and it will not hurt your system performance if you don't choose a number here. Compress on wire by default is selected as yes. This will just allow us to compress the data as we send it across the wire to the remote site. Keep in mind that the starter license does not allow compress on wire, so you'll need to manually check this as no if you have a starter license. And then the vStore name mappings is very important. This is where we actually map the containers from the source site to the remote site. So on our source site, our container is called Tech Topics, and that's where our VM lives. The destination, however, does not have a container named Tech Topics, so we will actually do CTR1, which should be the container on the remote site. We will click Add, and that sets up the mapping. So let's click Save. We can then click on Remote Site and see that it does in fact exist, but without setting it up on the remote site to mirror this, nothing is going to work yet. So let's go do that. All right, so now that we've mirrored the configuration from our source site to our remote site, we're ready to actually begin our replication. You can see we already have an async DR protection domain set up. We do have local snapshots set up as well. However, we need to set this up to work with the remote site. This is all done through the schedule. So let's go to the schedule. You can either create a new one or edit what's already there. I'm going to edit our schedule. And all we have to do is simply choose over here under our retention policy if we want this information to be replicated over to the remote site. So we're going to choose Tech Topics, and let's keep two snapshots there. We'll click Save. And just like that, it's been configured to use the remote site. However, you can see our next snapshot time isn't until tomorrow. So if we want to create a replication right now, we can click the Replicate button. When we click replicate, again, we'll have to choose the remote site we want to send it to. Let's choose a start time of now, and let's have this expire after one day. Once we click save, that one-shot replication should go right ahead and go. The amount of time that it takes the snapshot to replicate over to the other site will depend on how large your VMs are. And please keep in mind that the first replication that happens will be a full replication. This means that whatever the size of the VMs, all of that data will be replicated across the wire. Subsequent snapshots following that will just be a delta of information between the two and should go much quicker. All right, so once we've got the replication started, we can see total ongoing has changed to 1, and we can actually monitor the status of the replication here. The direction will tell us that it's outgoing, we can see which protection domain is associated with it, and of course the remote site, the snapshot start time, and the data completed. The data completed will slowly refresh. You can manually refresh your screen if you want to see this increment. And once it's been fully replicated, it will disappear from the total ongoing, and we will see it down here under last successful. We'll just have our one last successful there. And we can see when that replication was made. So if we go into our remote site, we can also see when we click on that async DR protection domain, which was created automatically by the remote site, if we go to local snapshots, we can see that we have one here. This is that completed replication. Notice that it's considered local here, but if we go back to the source site, it's considered a remote snapshot that it sees on the other site. All right, we'll take a break here, and we'll pick up next time on part 2 of the TechTopX remote site video.